Hey everybody, Brion McClanahan here. Are you looking for a great website that gives you history the way it was intended to be told, with no PC, no Marxism, no progressivism? Well, I've got it for you. It's learntruehistory.com. That's learntruehistory.com. Learn history from great professors who don't sugarcoat it for you. This is not for your delicate flowers. That's learntruehistory.com. learntruehistory.com. This is the Brion McClanahan Show. 3, 2, 1, 0. This is episode 7 of the Brion McClanahan Show. Welcome back. Glad to have you back on the show. And so today I want to make a statement that I think anyone who listens to this podcast, anyone who probably shares my beliefs, would say, and that is Keith Olbermann is an idiot. Now, why do I want to talk about Keith Olbermann today? Who really cares about Keith Olbermann? Because Keith Olbermann has basically vanished after being fired from two political gigs. He had his own show, he got fired from that. Then he did a sports show where he ran his mouth too much and got fired for that. I mean, go figure. Keith Olbermann really is nothing more than a sportscaster with a big mouth. But he's made quite a name for himself over the years, particularly with his Worst Man in America pieces that he used to do on his show. And full disclosure, Keith Olbermann with two N's one time called me the Worst Man in America. And so I have something to give back to Keith Olbermann. This is about 4 years ago. So it's been a while. I haven't talked about Keith Olbermann since then. I didn't really talk about it then at all. You know, I think a lot of people ignored Keith Olbermann. His show had very poor ratings. But because of his fame on SportsCenter, and I'll have to admit, when he was on SportsCenter years ago, when I was in as an undergraduate in college, I quite liked his performance on that show. He and Dan Patrick did a very good job anchoring SportsCenter. But again, he was a sportscaster, and he was okay at that. He had some very funny things to say at times about sports. And some of the things he said about sports I actually agreed with. I don't agree with his politics. And he wrote a piece. Actually, let me back up. I was alerted to this issue with Keith Olbermann, one I'm going to talk about today. Somebody had emailed me and said, Olbermann was on The View now. And he said that Donald Trump would be the worst presidential candidate, or is the worst presidential candidate, since 1864 in George B. McClellan. And his position was that if McClellan had won, we'd have a complete disaster. The Union would have been destroyed, et cetera, et cetera. He was, pro-slavery. And so that piqued my interest because I always want to bash Keith Olbermann with two N's. And so I went out and started doing some looking about this. And this is actually the statement that he made on The View. He was doubling down on a position he had taken in early March in an op-ed for the Washington Post. Now, number one, Keith Olbermann is so irrelevant now that he has to go on The View or on write op-eds for the Washington Post, and those are the only people that really care about what Keith Olbermann with two N's thinks. Now, the piece that he wrote on March 8th was talking about how he's going to move out of Donald Trump's property because he just can't stand Donald Trump anymore. Because Donald Trump, this is the funny part, there's two things in this piece I want to get into. But first of all, he's going to move out of this Trump property because he doesn't like Trump, and the real reason is because of Donald Trump's discourse. And this is coming from a guy who said, and he even admits his hypocrisy in this, but he says, Donald Trump has debased political discourse because he's bombastic and loudmouth, and he pokes fun at people he doesn't like. This is coming from a guy who's bombastic and loudmouth and pokes fun at people he doesn't like. I mean, this is hypocrisy at the highest level, but oh my gosh, I can't stand this. This guy is degrading public discourse. My goodness. Where do we start and where do we stop with the left and the political class being hypocrites? But here is, I would say Olbermann is definitely part of the political class. I mean, he had a talk show on television, MSNBC. He was, a lot of lefties liked him. So he's, to me, part of the political class. He gives to leftist campaigns. So he's not someone who is who's just sitting idly by as kind of a, someone who takes shots at individuals. He is definitely part and parcel of that class. Makes a lot of money doing what he does. So I don't consider Keith Olbermann, and of course he's not in office, so you could say that, well, because he's not in office, he's not a part of the political class. But I would think that on the left, you know, Olbermann at one time was one of the more influential individuals in the political class or in the political establishment. So that part of it's very funny. You know, the first part of it's the rant against Donald Trump, and I was, you know, this is a junior high school rant in so many ways. It's, you know, Olbermann is not, would never be confused with the world's best writer. So the part that really got me was when he started talking about George B. McClellan, and his historical ignorance here is just profound. So let me read to you what he said about McClellan in this piece, and of course then he doubled down, as I said, on The View. So he says, quote, "And it isn't as though the American electorate hasn't always had a soft spot for exactly the worst possible person for the presidency. 2 months before the 1864 vote, some Republicans were so thoroughly convinced that Abraham Lincoln would lose in a landslide that they proposed to hold a second Republican convention and nominate somebody to run in his place. The Democrat they feared, George B. McClellan, was not only probably the worst general in the history of the country, but also his campaign platform was predicated on stopping the Civil War, giving the South whatever it wanted, running the greatest president in history out of town, and repudiating the Emancipation Proclamation. Even after the North's victory at Atlanta turned the tide of the war and thus the election, McClellan, anti-Union, anti-Lincoln, anti-victory, and pro-slavery, still got 45% of all-Northern vote." All right, so there's so many problems with this particular paragraph. I'm going to go through this. Because my job as a historian is to shed light or shine the light on idiocy. And in this particular case, Keith Olbermann, like I said, is an idiot. And the thing that's so funny about this is Olbermann, on The View even, he started talking about, well, you know, my gosh, you know, Joy Behar said, my gosh, you know, how, God, should we dislike Lyndon Johnson and Richard Nixon and these people that, because they were escalating war, and we just don't like war. We're so anti-war. And Olbermann says, oh, yeah. I mean, we can't like those guys because, you know, Donald Trump has got his finger on the nuclear button, and my gosh, this would be terrible. They just ignored that Olbermann said that the problem with George B. McClellan is he would have ended the war. This is coming from an anti-war guy. McClellan would have ended the war. Wait a second here. The two things, we're worried about Trump nuking people, which wouldn't happen, number one. But we're worried about Trump nuking people, and yet you're not going to take into account that the guy that you call the greatest president in American history led to the bloodletting of a million people, the most massive bloodletting in American history? Crazy. So let me get into this statement that he made about Olbermann with two ends, I'm sorry, about McClellan. Olbermann with two ends made about McClellan. So, and I published a piece on LouRockwell.com today on this, and so I'm going to summarize some of this. You can go out and read it, and hopefully you'll enjoy it. The platform that Olbermann so vehemently disagrees with in this paragraph was a peace platform designed to stop the bloodletting. So let me get this straight. The guy that's anti-war is against a peace platform. Why? Because he thinks that would be the worst thing in American history, to stop the destruction of the Constitution and of, you know, this massive war that had been going on in 1864 now for about 3 years. Olbermann wanted that war to be continued at all costs because it was necessary at that point. Killing 1 million men is necessary. He mentions the Emancipation Proclamation. Forget the fact that the Emancipation Proclamation was unconstitutional. Former Supreme Court Justice Benjamin Robbins Curtis brought this up. And when I've been doing publicity for my 9 presidents who screwed up America, I talk about this, and people are shocked about this. And I say, look, the Emancipation Proclamation was an illegal move by the executive branch. He has no power. Lincoln had no power. The president has no power to do exactly what Lincoln did. Now, Lincoln's justification for it was that he could do anything to best subdue the enemy. And Benjamin Robbins Curtis pointed out that this was a very dangerous precedent to take. Because if you use this precedent, then you can do anything you want in a time of war as President of the United States to best subdue the enemy. And we're seeing the byproduct of that today in the war on terror. We saw it with the Cold War. We saw it during World War I and World War II. So this is where they get this. This is the Pandora's box that Lincoln opened that can never be closed. And Olbermann, obviously, is completely ignorant of that fact. You know, this was illegal. And forget the fact that in the Emancipation Proclamation, first of all, everyone knows it didn't free one slave, but there's also the important part of the Emancipation Proclamation. Lincoln issued it, but then suspended it for a time, basically trying to dangle a carrot in front of the South. Hey, look, if you stop fighting, come back in the Union, we're not going to do this. We're not going to free any slaves. So even the Emancipation Proclamation did not make ending slavery a war aim, particularly when it was first issued. And I'll get into the Union part in a second, what Lincoln thought about the Union. But here it is. I mean, this is clear. The Emancipation Proclamation was not this great event that everyone says it was. It didn't end slavery anywhere. And slavery still could exist. I mean, Lincoln would have said, look, I'm not going to issue this. If you just come back in, you can keep your slaves, just come back in the Union. So it's very clear, even in the Emancipation Proclamation, the point of the proclamation was to save the Union. It's basically the same thing that King George III had done through his surrogates in the colonies when they advocated slave insurrection in the South during the American War for Independence. And you have to remember that every colony, then state, had slavery in 1776. Every one. But of course, the aim was Virginia with George III's move. So I often bring this up with people and they say, well, you know, the American War for Independence is different. How? I mean, how is it different? The War of 1861 and the American War for Independence, there's no difference in what they were trying to do, and that's seek independence. Okay. And that's a whole other issue that we'll get into some other day. And so, you know, I mentioned, you know, forget that slavery still existed in the Union until December 1865. And that McClellan said not one word that be considered pro-slavery. I mean, Olbermann with two N makes the case that McClellan was pro-slavery. I've not read one statement from George B. McClellan that ever said he was pro-slavery. He had the same position. Now, you could say that he's pro-slavery because he said, look, I mean, slavery is legal. It's not unconstitutional. That is the exact same position Abraham Lincoln took at the beginning of the war. The exact same position that virtually every other Northerner held at the beginning of the war and throughout the war. And all you have to do is go back and look at the Corwin Amendment with the original proposal for a 13th Amendment, the Corwin Amendment, that Lincoln supported. He even mentioned he supported it in his first inaugural address. And the Corwin Amendment would have made slavery permanent. It would not allow the federal government to interfere with slavery in the states where it already existed. And that was another carrot proposal. Hey, South, if you just won't secede, don't declare independence, look at this. We got the Corwin Amendment. Just come on back in. Slavery's protected. And the South didn't do it. Lincoln supported that. So is Lincoln really anti-slavery? No, not at all. He's pro-union. Now, what union he's going to get is, I mentioned this in a second, but this is what the war was for, the Union. So when Olbermann makes the case that, first of all, McClellan was pro-slavery, he wasn't. It's just so stupid. Also forget the fact that this worst general in American history delivered one of the fatal blows to the Confederate Army at Sharpsburg in 1862. This allowed Lincoln to issue the unconstitutional Emancipation Proclamation, but, of course, McClellan delivered that blow. This is the guy that was the worst general in American history. Forget the fact the war was unconstitutional from day one, and as per the Constitution, the very definition of treason, if you follow Lincoln's logic. This is a very interesting issue. You know, Lincoln's constitutional position was that the South wasn't legally out of the Union. They were just states in rebellion. So if you follow that logic, now there's a state of rebellion. And Congress, if you look at Article 1, Section 8, Congress can use the army to subdue rebellion. But there is a a caveat to that. In order for the army to be sent into a state, it has the general government has to have the permission of the state legislature or the executive of the state if the state legislature is not in session. Well, I dare say that Lincoln did not have the authority from any of the southern state legislatures or the executives to send in the army. They would have said, oh, we got this insurrection, we're good. So the very definition of treason in the Constitution is waging war against them, which is them being the states. So Lincoln, if the states are still in the Union, would be committing treason because he's waging war against them, the states. But of course, this gets into the legal position of secession. Is secession legal or not? Again, I can tackle that issue some other day. I've firmly come down to the side that secession is perfectly legal. I also say, forget the fact that the Democratic campaign platform explicitly stated, I'm going to quote you from the 1864 Democratic platform that Olbermann links to in his article, and he says, these people are anti-union. The Democrats were anti-union in 1864. McClellan was anti-union in 1864. Remember, this is exactly what Olbermann said. McClellan was anti-union, anti-Lincoln. Well, I agree with that one. Anti-victory and pro-slavery. Nah, he wasn't anti-victory. In fact, one thing that people don't realize with McClellan, a lot of the peace Democrats, those who had advocated a peace, were not happy with McClellan's choice. They would have preferred someone like Horatio Seymour because McClellan was much more of a war Democrat than a peace Democrat. I mean, he was of the mind that we've started this war, we have to finish it. But I think he would have been receptive to peace overtures by the South. And yes, at that particular case, the South would have gone. So this is bad for Olbermann. The South would have gotten everything they wanted. But there were abolitionists who would who were fine with secession. Lysander Spooner, for example. William Lloyd Garrison in 1848 advocated secession because they just thought, well, look, we'll just get rid of those southern states. They can have their slaveholding republic. We've got our free republic. So this is the part I'm going to quote you from the 1864 platform. Quote, that the aim and object of the Democratic Party is to preserve the federal union and the rights of the states unimpaired. Doesn't sound anti-union to me, but it does sound anti-Lincoln union because they recognize something. They recognize that Lincoln was trampling the ballot, suppressing civil liberties, destroying the Constitution. That's not the union they wanted. They wanted the original union, the original Constitution. The Democratic Party did seek to restore peace, quote, on the basis of the federal union of the states. Again, sounds pretty pro-union to me. Or the fact that McClellan said after accepting the nomination that, quote, the preservation of the union was the avowed object for which the war was commenced. Again, sounds pretty pro-union to me, just not Lincoln pro-union. A coercive union where you force people into a union they don't want to be part of. So is Olbermann, I mean, he's an authoritarian. He's a pro-war authoritarian. Well, we know he's authoritarian because he's on the left, and the modern left is authoritarian. That's what they want. They want to force their particular worldview on everybody. It's a one-size-fits-all policy. I talked about this in a previous podcast. This is what they want to do. Everything's a national, quote-unquote, national issue, so they're going to force their will on everybody else. So again, Olbermann is supporting something. He's supporting the destruction of the Constitution. The greatest president in America. I mean, and of course, you know, the View people are just so stupid. They gloss right over this because they don't know what they're talking about, just like Olbermann doesn't really know what he's talking about. And so Olbermann said that, you know, the 45 people that voted for McClellan were idiots. No, the 45 people that supported McClellan were not the idiots. The 55% of the people that voted for Lincoln were the idiots. He was the worst possible person for the presidency in 1864. This is where Olbermann should avoid any kind of political statements. I mean, he knows box scores and jock straps, but I'm not sure he knows what he's talking about and much of anything else. I found it very interesting that someone would actually bring up George McClellan and say this is an example of the worst candidate in American history. I can think of a lot worse. Some of them were elected, like Woodrow Wilson, like Franklin Roosevelt, like Harry Truman, like Lyndon Johnson, like Abraham Lincoln, like Teddy Roosevelt. I can think of a lot worse, like Barack Obama, like George W. Bush, like George H.W. Bush, like Bill Clinton, Richard Nixon. There's a lot worse out there than George B. McClellan. So I think it's funny that people are, you know, someone like Olbermann is worried about Donald Trump. They're the same person. I mean, they're both from New York. They both have the same style. They've both done the same things. And again, you know, Olbermann recognizes it's hypocrisy, but this is funny that someone, that Olbermann would have a problem with someone like this when he is like that. And he thinks that, you know, political discourse needs to be much, you know, much more lofty level. Like what? Calling people the worst man in America? That's the lofty level you want? Like making statements in your piece that are so juvenile, a junior high school student could have written them? That's the kind of rhetoric you want? So, I find it fun. You know, the thing about the Trump campaign has been fun. You bring out people out of the, you know, they come out of the weeds like Keith Olbermann. Olbermann's just, he's irrelevant now. He's gone from being somewhat, you know, having a bad career to a worse career to an irrelevant career. And, you know, people are asking him, are you going to come out of retirement? What for? Nobody really cares what he thinks. You know, the only place he can have any platform are leftist organizations that, you know, but everyone else really doesn't care what he thinks. And so I find it funny that this is the kind of thing. That, I mean, Donald Trump is putting people into such a frothing rage that they're going to, you know, move out of his building. And again, I've said in other places, you know, what has Donald Trump really said that's so incendiary other than we're going to build a wall and we're going to stop illegal immigration? I mean, it's funny. And one of his, some of his greatest supporters are African-Americans. You know, what has Donald Trump said that's so racist or so sinister? This is where we're in this very strange Orwellian doublespeak today where you say if someone's a criminal, that's somehow, you know, a non-PC statement to make. So anyways, I thought it was fun to point out how Olbermann, and again, I was alerted to this, and I didn't even know about it. This is how, I didn't even know that Olbermann had said this. There was a piece about it in The Hill, and but it's funny that, you know, Olbermann has had to come out of the woodwork because of, you know, Donald Trump. But George B. McClellan was not the worst presidential candidate in American history. In 1864, the worst candidate of the two was Abraham Lincoln. And there's no doubt that Lincoln's job as president set the stage, or Lincoln's performance as president set the stage for someone like Barack Obama. Lincoln did a terrible job defending his oath of office to preserve, protect, and defend the Constitution of the United States. That's the position I took in my book, Nine Presidents Who Screwed Up America. If you haven't gotten a copy of that, I would highly recommend it. It's available everywhere books are sold. Definitely online, Amazon, Barnes & Noble, Books A Million, Walmart. So go on out and pick up a copy of that if you haven't done so. But I'll just say this, again, closing like I opened with. Keith Olbermann is an idiot. See you next time.